everybody.
Hi.
How's it going? This is awesome. Thanks for coming. We're going to talk about journalism today, journalism and podcasting. I always get asked all kinds of crazy questions about it, so I'm so glad that I get to like ask those questions to other people and not to myself. And not have to answer them. There, as you guys know, there have been tons of think pieces lately about this idea that, you know, in the age of podcasts and digital delivery of content, is NPR and radio going to survive? And I'm definitely not going to talk about any of that or weigh in on it because I'm totally not interested, because I don't think that's like the question that we need to be asking. And I think also what it does, it like sets up this binary world where it's like news organizations over here and podcasts over here, podcasts and all other forms of new media over here, as if they're these two competing things. And I think that's kind of false, and I think it's just sort of kind of annoying, and it's a little boring. So, you know, when people call me up for interviews, these questions that I get asked, the questions I'm not going to ask today, but the ones that have kind of got me thinking about what we should talk about today, these questions are like, which one's better? You know, is new media better than old media? Is news dying? Will all these entertainment podcasts out there, with all these entertainment podcasts out there, who will ever want, you know, a daily diet of news again? As if like somehow these like fun, hilarious, you know, endeavors will like make us all stop like caring about the world or something. But we, like, you know, we all know there's tons of journalism being committed every single day in a whole bunch of places and a whole bunch of worlds. And that is a world that I am really excited about. Journalism is a thing I believe in very deeply. And I'm just super excited about all the different ways we can do it. And so we're going to talk about that with people here. We thought it'd be just a really great idea to assemble some of the people who are doing the best work in this field and ask more serious questions about podcasting and journalism, like how are podcasts and other forms allowing us to do more and better journalism? And in a world where we can measure pretty closely who's listening, how long they're listening, is there too much emphasis on metrics and not enough on the editorial questions that drive traditional news outlets? And also another question that I always get asked that I actually do want to ask you guys is, do these new forms make us more or less subjective, and does that matter? And so I want to introduce our guests. We've got Hanna Rosin. She is one of the newest additions to the amazing podcast from NPR Invisibilia.
Hi.
Just dropped the episode, which is really great. I just listened to it last night. It's awesome. She's, of course, also a former writer at Atlantic and Slate, and was a founder and editor at XX Gabfest, has written a whole bunch of other places, long career in investigative journalism and print journalism. And so welcome to you, Hanna. And I'm going to just introduce everybody, and then I'm going to kind of ask them some questions, and then we're going to open it up to you guys. We also have with us Francesca Panetta. She is special projects editor at The Guardian. She actually works for the visuals team at The Guardian. You're like, why would you have somebody come in here to talk about that? She has actually produced a bunch of radio, is a total audiophile, made this amazing podcast 2 years ago for The Guardian called The Biggest Story in the World. If you haven't listened to it, it's so cool. The editor of The Guardian, as he was going out, decided that he wanted to make climate change his great legacy project. And so this podcast actually followed him and everyone at The Guardian during this process of like figuring out what the hell are we going to do and how can we make people care about this thing that everybody needs to care about. But now she's actually not really doing podcasts. She's working in virtual reality, and we are really excited to have her. So welcome, Francesca. It'll be really fun to talk about that. We also have Maria Hinojosa. She is the anchor and executive producer of Latino USA, which we all know is a great radio program, which is also now a podcast. And we are excited to talk about that, and welcome to you.
Thank you.
And of course, I'm Kelly McEvers. I'm one of the hosts of All Things Considered and a podcast called Embedded. So, yeah. So I want to start just asking some like nerdy journalism questions of our panelists, and then we'll talk about these sort of bigger questions that I brought up. If you want to do that, or if you want to talk about anything else, we can do that, and then we'll let you guys have a go at it. And Hanna, I wanted to start with you. You know, you've come from print, and I'm sure that's an interesting transition. And I wonder if you think about, you know, when you think about like a long form Atlantic piece or a piece in the New Yorker, and then you think about how that same piece might be executed in podcast form, do you feel like it's a it's reductive? Like, do you feel like...
I feel like the radio version would accomplish something and the print version would accomplish something different. So if you're perfectly honest, turning a piece into radio, I don't think quite allows you to get the intellectual nuance. Like, there are certain ideas, not stories, but ideas that are a little difficult to even get into an hour of radio. You can do it, but you have to do it sort of really well, like one at a time, and sort of land them with emotional impact. And you're really good at it. I mean, going from turning a print story, but then on the other hand, what the print story doesn't allow you to really kind of point the arrow at the deep emotional impact of a situation in anywhere near the kind of level of intimacy and profundity that I think a radio story can do. So I think each medium has an advantage. But what, like, if you've tried to get, you know, you have a big story and then you try to get people to do it in an alternate form, how does that... And again, I have to say that first question you started with, it's not like this is new. There are beautiful movies that are made out of magazine stories. It happens all the time. They're slightly different than the magazine stories, and they accomplish different things, or books. So it's not that new a question. But how do you, like, if you think of the most successful example of where you've managed to get some journalists to turn something into a different medium, what does it look like?
Yeah, I started The Guardian 10 years ago, just when we were setting up the podcasting department and kind of ran the audio team there. And at the beginning, it was really tough because journalists would come right at the end of the process with their stories and say, now let's turn this into a podcast. And it'd be like, this is too late.
Right.
You needed to involve us right in the beginning.
It's easy, right?
And over time, we've built relationships with the journalists. They understand what making a, you know, what a story in film looks like, what a story in podcast form looks like. And we can kind of produce right from the beginning. But it's taken a long time for them to understand the kind of production process and the difference in forms.
It's funny you mentioned the emotional impact of certain characters and ideas in stories and how that is so much more important when you're podcasting, because I feel like I get asked this all the time. And it seems kind of like a gendered question to me sometimes, where it's like, your stories are so emotional, you know, you really get at the emotion. And, you know, you don't normally do that in the news and stuff like that. So, I mean, I know that we actually do have to do that when we're making good radio, because we want to connect with people. We want the stories to create some kind of empathy. But I wonder about that, like, just this idea of, like, more emotional than a print story.
I think it can be personality as well. It doesn't have to be kind of saccharine emotion.
Right.
So what we started to do when we set up our podcast was like irreverence and humor. So it's like it's got the kind of rigor of journalism, but we can add kind of character to it. So I think that it can be emotion in a really kind of broad scale.
Also, anger is an emotion.
Yeah.
Fury is an emotion. Yeah. I mean, as it happens, like, a lot of my stories have men crying, but that's
not the
only way.
Yeah.
There are other ways. So.
Did you want to talk about that? Just this idea of, like, making, you know, pieces emotional and connecting with people in that
you
way.
You know, it's actually very interesting because many times in my career, because of who I am, I mean, the fact that I was born in Mexico, I'm an immigrant, I'm a woman. I studied at Barnard College, so it must mean that I'm a feminist, I'm a short person, so I must have some kind of short person's agenda, you know.
I didn't know there was such a thing. That's
awesome. No.
Sweet.
And actually, at my core as a journalist, I always understood that it was about connecting with the heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is an agenda that great journalists in the history of this country have had. You know, from Edward R. Murrow to Frederick Douglass, it was about making that connection. So for us, in terms of Latino USA, which last year won a Peabody, I think because we were able to do this, we're very, very proud of that.
You can say it again.
We won a Peabody last year. And I think it has to do with the fact that what we're doing is that we're able to have that emotional connection. We're doing great radio, right? Great audio. But then you've got to have the great journalism that's what we're able to do. And I think that that's what this panel is about, is that it is about creating a sentiment, a moment, something that you are lingering on. But it's also that you're learning something very profound about our country or about the world or about an issue. And those two things are coming together. And I think that that's the best of journalism. And you know what? As a woman, you know, I understand the issue of it being a gendered question. But actually, I think it's actually more an element of a great journalist. And I actually learned to really hone that from Scott Simon when I was his producer. He's not a woman.
Most of the time. Okay, great journalism. What is it? Like, what if people are wanting to make, or saying like, oh, you know, do I do the podcast about that's about comedy, or do I do the podcast that's about journalism? What would you tell them? You know, what are the elements that they need to have, right? They need to connect on this emotional level, but what else do they need to do?
You're saying do if somebody's trying to start a podcast?
Sure. Yeah, I don't know. I just threw that out there.
Or just... Oh, I mean, so as a newcomer to the audio world, I would say the thing that I love the most about it is that it just feels like it's going in 100 different directions at once. You know, right now it still conceives of itself as a fairly like a small kind of club, but it's moving away from that idea, so that that's what's fun about it. There's like space for the comedy ones and space for, you know, whole podcasts about investigative journalism and other ones mm-hmm. about crime. I mean, there's so many good podcasts like right now that I think it's history podcasts. I mean, if you ever look at the top charts, they're just a churning of these.
And Bill Simmons.
Endless, yeah. Incredibly. And it's actually great. I mean, yeah. That's what I like. So that question of, can you do real reporting? Can you do news? And of course, like it hasn't been maybe, you know, nobody's figured out exactly the most fulsome way to do it yet, but that's why it's cool, because people are doing that.
But there is something about, I mean, I think, and I I consume it all in multiple ways, but there is also something about, not laughing your way through something that is journalistically really important, where there is meat. And we have to also recognize that if we are journalists, we have a role to play in this moment in history. So I want to laugh. I want to be entertained. But at the same time, when I'm hearing an investigative piece, it's not about, you know, it's not about that at that moment. It is understanding, like, I'm going to go deep into this, and this is the great thing about American journalism that we can do.
But there are documentaries, I don't understand that there are documentaries that are investigative and break news even. So like, sure. why couldn't there be audio that is documentary and breaks? It doesn't seem like that difficult.
It's interesting, there's this assumption out there though sometimes, I think when you're working in this form and other places, that it's like less rigorous somehow. You know what I mean? Because you haven't sat down with like the big boss editor and gone over your 3,000 word piece a bunch of times and had it had every single word fact checked with the little check mark. You know, that somehow it's not as rigorous as that kind of journalism. And you know, I always tell people like it's like more rigorous. Like, you know, if you're gonna put out 40 minutes or an hour on the radio, my God, there's gonna be like 1,000 people editing that and fact checking that. But I think that's something that kind of gets lost in the discussion, is just how important that still is.
Or
you know, all
sense.
Those like dorky traditional things that we right. think about of an old newsroom, it's still like hugely important. We've got like librarians going through every single line and making sure like actually it's 35 miles, not 36. Right. You know what
right.
I mean? Like that's super important still. Right.
Or yeah. maybe people associate podcasting with storytelling in
right.
a way, and so in their head, storytelling is something different from serious journalism, which in my head, it
right.
isn't. Like,
no,
they're
right.
the same, so.
Right. In some ways, and so our editing process, I was just interesting, was we have kind of editing, the fact-checking editing process and the storytelling editing process, mm-hmm. and they kind of exist in two places for a mm-hmm. while, and then they kind of come together mm-hmm. in the end to make sure we're both right and, you know, hopefully good. Francesca, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about just what you're up to, because mm-hmm. you're like podcasting. So 2 years ago, you're like in this blue world of VR. You have this amazing project called 6x9. I wonder uh-huh. if you could just tell us about that a little bit.
Yeah. So 2 months ago, I launched 6x9, which is a virtual reality piece about solitary confinement in US prisons. And I worked on it for about 9 months. So you are in the position of a incarcerated prisoner, and you hear the voices. I interviewed 7 people who were previously incarcerated in New York and California, and 2 psychologists who've been studying the psychological effects of solitary confinement. And throughout the piece, you hear them talking to you and talking you through that kind of 9-minute experience. So it was absolutely built from audio up. All my projects are built kind of audio up, even if they're multimedia interactives, even if they're films. That's kind of always been the way that I've worked. So essentially, I kind of cut it almost as a radio piece and then started building the visuals on top of that. We built it in CGI and went scene by scene through it on top of the audio narrative.
Right, and so there's also like a space that you can stand in, right, and experience this piece.
Well, you put on the goggles, and all around you, you're in the cell.
Right.
Yeah.
And then it's 9 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And what else, and that's interesting you say audio up. I mean, is that just, do you think, because that's your experience, or do you think it's because you think that's the best way to put together a story?
I think both.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like, talking heads are just not very interesting to look at. So whether it's film or whether it's multimedia pieces or whether it's virtual reality, you don't particularly want to see, most of the time for kind of interviews, I'm not very interested in seeing the people talking at me. So I would be, I think it's much better just to get the audio and then think about really creative visual treatments around that. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, just to continue our journalism, I've read a lot of great stories about solitary confinement. Mm-hmm. I have read a lot of testimonies from people who were in solitary confinement, diaries of people, and it's
a different form.
Exactly, it's just a different form of understanding that experience. It's profound, it's intimate, it's visual. It's just a different way of, that's no more or less journalism than any other form of this is journalism,
yeah,
I think.
And it's different from a film as well. Like, mm-hmm. So I've watched loads of documentaries, amazing documentaries, which have got, character development and, all the things that a documentary would. This is experiential. It's trying to give you a bit of a sense of what it's like to be in solitary confinement. So it's just a different genre.
Right. I always say, the best audio and radio storytelling is it forces people to stand in the shoes of people that they would never stand in, right? And this is like that times 10.
Exactly.
What other things do you see in audio going forward that are exciting to you in terms of how we can commit journalism in other places?
I think the online space is very interesting in terms of data visualizations, in terms of interactive documentaries is something I'm really interested in kind of geolocated audio, where you are depends on what you hear. So I think there's loads of different applications for audio in innovation.
For us, I think that part of the beauty of this moment in history is that because Latino USA exists as a radio show, it's a national radio show. In fact, even though we've been on the air for almost 25 years, our numbers keep going up, which is kind of beautiful. And it's a beautiful space because it's a radio space, but we also exist as a podcast with 2 very different audiences, which is really interesting to just have 2 very different audiences and yet be able to connect with both of them. One that happens upon us that is predominantly NPR, public radio audience, more white, and the other one that chooses to listen to us as a podcast. But the other thing that's happened for us is that we are creating new material. So, for example, and it's journalistic, but it's different journalistically, right? So it's not investigative, which is something that we are doing, but we created a political podcast called In the Thick because we felt like in this moment, in this election year, people of color, journalists, Latinos, et cetera, have a particular take on what's happening politically that we need to own. So that's the beauty of this space, and we created that from nothing. And again, our numbers continue to grow with that, but that is the beauty of what you were saying, Hannah, in that sense that there's just so many possibilities. Of course, the challenge is that there's also so much stuff,
right?
So how do we get through it all and not feel entirely overwhelmed, which then I think at some points, you just are like, I can't listen to anything for 2 days. I'm not going to listen to a thing except for the birds. Which is something that, we also, there's the overload, although too much information in our day and age at a time when we still have an abundance of ignorance, I don't think is a problem.
It's interesting working in a newsroom, you've got a lot of journalists who are like, oh, sweet, podcast, that means my stories can be longer? Awesome. Like there is this instinct to just be like, let's just do more and just like throw more of this out there. And I think we're kind of at a time where we have to think about not being too flabby too, absolutely, like you said. I mean, it's a great world. We're gonna just like, right, I'll just make a podcast about that.
Right.
Burgers on 4th Street and like, or whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, what's that all about? Like, why is that guy that, no. But, but you know, I was just having a conversation with a friend about this last night. You know, I was like, I'm gonna do a whole season about this thing. And he's like, do you really need to do that? Or is that just an hour? You know, and I was like, oh, okay. I mean, but so it's like a thing, it's a thing to think about. Like, we're in this sort of luxurious time where we can just like, we feel like we can do, mm-hmm, anything. I don't know. I'd love to hear everybody's thoughts about that. What do you think, Francesca?
I mean, that's certainly when I'm doing kind of training for new producers, I'm always like, keep it tight. It's,
yeah,
so, especially like the length. I mean, you're talking about kind of the whole series, but just one podcast, like, don't let it just sprawl and sprawl. Like, keep it tight.
Right.
If you're in doubt,
yeah,
squash,
yeah,
it.
Exactly.
Squash it.
In doubt, kill the thing. Yeah. And Maria, you know, you're talking about your listenership, and I did want to definitely talk about metrics and like how that changes what we do. You do have two different audiences, and I think that's really interesting. Mm-hmm. Has that changed content-wise, like your approach or the way you tell stories, and like just the fact that we can get all this feedback and we know exactly when people push pause and when they skip and like when they listen, how long they listen.
You know, a lot of stuff. It hasn't really, I mean, this is the beauty of of creating your own newsroom, because I created Futuro Media Group, which is in Harlem, if you ever want to come visit 125th Street. Mm-hmm. lots of internship opportunities, some staff too. so basically, the staff has been so consistent in the sense that we're not thinking, oh boy, we have a majority Anglo audience on public radio and we have a majority Latinx millennial audience in our podcasts and a large percentage of African-American listeners also. So no, we try to do what journalists do, right? Is that we encourage each other, we push each other to, you know, get the best story, to make sure that it's tight, then make sure that it's journalistically sound, that's gonna be great radio. And I think that integrity, that authenticity of the voice is what has allowed us to grow. But it isn't because we sit there and go like, oh. Now, we do know some metrics, and I have to tell you, you know, having worked at CNN for a long time, where, you know, at the beginning of CNN, God bless them, you know, metrics meant nothing. And then kind of when I got there, it was right when Time Warner had taken over, and there was a lot of competition from Fox, and suddenly I was in a news, an editorial meeting for our show on prime time. And suddenly we had a metrics person who came in and he said, well, you know, we have minute by minute ratings now. And you know what? Covering war, not so good for ratings. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know? So the metric things is, it's also dangerous. I think that we as producers and as journalists, this is what we do. This is how we make the sausage, right? It's our ear, it's our conversations, it's challenging each other, and that's gonna make tight journalism, mm-hmm, that people wanna listen to. And that's our job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you guys have thoughts on metrics? I mean, because like, we can say that they don't come into play, like, you know what I mean? But I just feel like sometimes they do anyway. Like, who doesn't read the comments?
When they're great, by the way, they're great. When,
yeah,
they're great.
Who doesn't,
yeah,
read,
yeah,
the reviews and the comments on iTunes?
Yeah.
You read them, right? You need the dopamine. Like, you have to. So, like, and then this, how, even you're like, that doesn't color my decision at all. I'm going to
say, okay, let me just say this. In terms of the, just, and then I'll hand it over. We get such deeply, our love letters have become so much more intense and intimate. The hate is getting like broader, like, stop, you know, why do you do your show in Spanish? And it's like, we don't. Go back to Mexico. Okay, I'm a US citizen, you know, like that kind of stuff. But the love, so you're right. I'm sorry, when you said dopamine, I was like, yep, that's us. We do get something out of that. But again, I try to make our staff really feel that it's about the great work and not about the what happens at, you know, 28 minutes or 36 minutes past the hour.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I want to talk about, you know, I want to open up this door of subjectivity, because I get asked it all the time. And I actually want to ask you guys about it, because it's one of the annoying questions that I want to hear thoughts on. Which is, you know, well, you have feelings in this, you know, beyond the emotional question, you have feelings in this podcast, you have thoughts in this podcast, you have opinions in this podcast. Aren't you now more subjective than you were before? You know, are you now not an objective journalist? What do you guys think about that?
I hate this question.
I'm sorry.
I mean, I feel like newsrooms make this distinction in the two that I've ever worked in. The distinction is, you know, you can't have opinions, but you can have feelings.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they walk that line.
And then we're good, right?
Yeah, okay. We're good. As long as you don't say anything like explicitly political.
Like, I'm really sad that this is happening, but I can't say one way or the other whether it should happen.
I'm not sure you could say I'm really sad. If this is like, you know, Donald Trump, I don't think you could say
either.
That, you know.
I mean, I think that in Britain, we embrace kind of opinion much more than in American papers.
I know.
Oh my God.
Just, you're at the Guardian,
British
for crying out loud.
I love the Guardian.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, we really feel at the Guardian, like, news is now, it's quite common. Like, you get your news sources from a lot of places. Like, the wires are providing news. I mean, good reporting is still important, mm-hmm. but, like, what is kind of unique about the big media organizations is good analysis, opinion, and that can come with personality along with it. So I set up our politics weekly show about 10 years ago, and my objective was to be as unlike the BBC as possible, to get all of our columnists in and make it sound like you're in the canteen with them, kind of gossiping and hearing their opinions. They're the cleverest people mm-hmm. in our newspaper, and you want to feel like you're sitting down and listening into their conversation. That is good journalism, but it's also really entertaining to listen to.
Yeah. Do they have opinions? I mean, do they?
Totally. I mean,
because we have a politics chat.
Untrain them, media train them.
Really?
You know, because they're all on the BBC all the time.
Right.
They know kind of
what the boundaries are.
Yeah. And I was like, forget all that. Try and just, you know, remember.
So
what
they
it's
would
like
they could say something like, this Trump guy, he's a joke.
Yeah. Absolutely. And to be honest, they really embrace it because they like that idea of, you know, they're there with, and it gives a nuance that often you don't get on kind of the national programs, where you're like, okay, we have to have one person from this side, one person from that side. It's got to be balanced. It's like, actually, we're going to have they're all going to be liberal, but like with different opinions and different. And it gives it a kind of, you know, that's something that the podcasting can do that often kind of broadcasting can't do, which is be niche, be excellent journalism, be really entertaining.
Right. Because we have a politics podcast too, and it's chatty, and it's, you know, when it's good, it's really funny and interesting, and it's like, you feel like, ooh, I'm sitting with the smarty pants nerds, and they're telling me all the things that I need to know, and that's great. But there's no way in a million years that they would ever say anything that sounds like even close to an opinion. But I think it's still entertaining. Like, I mean, this question of, like, is having an opinion like inherently entertaining, and without it isn't. Yeah,
well,
I wonder.
It doesn't have to be entertaining.
Yeah, right. You just have to be entertaining without having. Yeah, exactly.
For us, the thing that comes up a lot is, especially at a time when we understand the profound demographic change that we're all experiencing, and the beautiful and challenging consequences as a result. But we have been in this process for the past, you know, 50 years. So, you know, when I was growing up, I know a bunch of you are going to be like, who's he? But, you know, it was like Walter Cronkite, right? I mean, like, he was the dude, and there was that he set the tone for what was objective, right? We don't see the world, and I worked for Walter Cronkite. I actually wrote for Walter Cronkite, and he actually read what I wrote for him on the air as his end of the year commentary. And when I was writing it, I was writing it as a journalist. I was not writing it then as a young Maria Hinojosa. The point is that what we question is, who gets to decide what's objective?
Right.
I mean, who decides that? Like, is there like the Bible of objectivity that we can all like kind of go and be like, oh yeah, this, you know? So we need to recognize that question in and of itself mm-hmm. is is complicated and weighted and has its own baggage that we have to kind of unpack.
Yeah, I mean, I was in Las Vegas with one of my kids recently. We were in Nevada. It's a totally conservative town. We were driving through. I was just reading the local newspaper, completely straight paper, not an opinion paper. They were doing stories about the election. They sounded so different than the stories in the New York Times. Just the basic framing of the story, who they chose to quote. It was like written as a completely objective news story. And what that made me realize is like, none of us are really object. Like, these guys are just writing a straight news story, but their fundamental assumptions are so different from the fundamental assumptions of people writing in New York that, like, I don't know which one's objective.
Right.
They're both pretty objective, you know?
Right. Why don't we let people ask questions? Are you guys ready to do that? You want to throw some stuff at us? Push back? argue, criticize? Please bring it.
I have been thinking about what you were just talking about, like who gets to decide what's objective, particularly reporting on Ferguson and Baltimore and feeling very viscerally relating to a lot of the things that were happening and wanting to talk about it and make people's experiences as fact, right? And so like the assumptions pieces, like starting from a place that assumes that this is something that is already fact, and then going through that and now kind of feeling like, oh, I want to like, you know, maybe move to another organization, and now feeling all this anxiety about whether that is going to be seen as more subjective in the way that that was reported. So advice, and also like, how do you bring your own experiences as facts to the way that you talk about a story?
I mean, it was a rough time in both of those stories, and I think around the question of looting, right, and rioting, and, you know, I mean, just like word choices in those, especially in the early days, that's always the worst time at any news organization, right, is when you don't know stuff, right, and then so you start saying stuff because you got to say some stuff. Like, there's like, the clock says 4 minutes, and my mic is open, and like, I got to say things. I got to say words, and that's when like words get said and then get repeated over and over again, and yeah, it's just like, that's a really kind of dangerous time, and I think on both of those stories, there was a lot of really good questions being asked about who says that's what it is. Are you basing this off of something that you're seeing on your news feed or off of actual reporting on the ground? Yep. Oh, yeah.
Also, though,
which Twitter?
Like,
which like, Twitter?
There's like a deeper thing here, which is I think young people are like deeply philosophically believe in subjectivity and the idea that there is no fact and there is no reality that we all agree on. So like in that context, like what is subjective?
I would bring it back to you as a journalist. And for you to own the fact that you're making choices about when you're reporting, about where you're going to go, who you're going to talk to, how you're going to talk to them, because of your experience, personally. But then as a journalist, you're also going to make sure that you get multiple opinions, because that's what we do. So I would just say for you to own a little bit more about the fact that as a journalist, who you are is going to inform the decisions that you're making as you're reporting the piece. And that's something that is a great thing, as opposed to somebody else who may be talking with somebody else about something else. Or as Kelly was saying, just putting words out there because they have to be put out there.
I feel the responsibility. It's almost like it becomes a social justice act. And that's kind of where the lines I always wonder, because I feel the responsibility to go talk to this person that's not getting talk to in other media outlets, you know? Like, even with Orlando,
but
like,
that's
I
a
made
good
sure.
Journalistic, that's something
yeah.
that's a strong journalistic decision.
Yep.
You want to talk to people who people aren't talking to.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what we do.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah, and until newsrooms look like America, like, that's, you know, we're going to need to tip the balance.
Hi. I'm just curious, like, you all work for larger organizations. Where do you draw the line about things that you want to follow and tell a story about and what you're doing for your organization? Like, this is very specific, but Maria did a story last year, or Latino USA did a story last year that NPR pulled. It was, like, called Chewy. It was about a Chicago politician, and NPR pulled it.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious where that line is.
That was the saddest day in my journalistic career. But 5 days later, we won a Peabody. Okay, so let me try and frame
time.
This story. Chuy Garcia was running for mayor against Rahm Emanuel in the city of Chicago. We had gotten deep access into the Chuy campaign like no other national media had gotten. And I actually understood it being a national story when I was in Austin, Texas, and they were in a dinner party with high-powered Latinos from all across the country, and they were talking about how they were funding the Chuy campaign in Chicago. These are people from LA, from Miami, from Houston. I was like, okay, this is a national story about what Latino leadership looks like, because there's always this question, what does Latino leadership look like? It looks like, and it's like, okay, well, here you have it. we decided that this was not, this was going to be like, you know, inside the Chewy campaign, this was not going to be Chewy versus Rahm Emanuel, because we knew that that was not the story that we were going to tell. And a national scale, that was not the story that Latino USA wanted to tell. So our problem and the reason why NPR had a problem with us, frankly, was so easy to do. All we needed to say was that we reached out to the Rahm Emanuel campaign on 15 different occasions and they never got back to us, or whatever, however many it was. I don't remember at this specific moment. If we had said that more than once, we would have been fine, because, again, the story was not about that. I think that the failure, and this is where, again, our journalism in podcasting has actually helped us to grow, is that no one else was doing the story about the Chewy campaign inside and what it meant for Latino leadership. And that is not a, taking a stand, but it is a point of view about that story, mm-hmm. as that Latino being a leader in a historical moment. It was a challenging moment, but still the journalism that we did do, we stand behind. And it was the week, it was so sad. You know, there's the technical stuff, the how you make the sausage stuff, and that week actually was a very difficult week, because I was going to say goodbye to my father, who was dying. And so I had to leave the office early to fly to Mexico. And so there were technical issues that, you know, also hindered us. But nonetheless, it was a great dialogue with NPR. I think there was a lot learned. And yeah, we wrote, yes, we did. We did. We wrote our own response to it. You know, so yeah, of course we pushed back, because we absolutely solidly stood behind the journalism that we did about that story that was not about Rahm Emanuel. And I just find it interesting that in the entire history of Latino USA being on the air, the only time that we have had this kind of a situation happened to do when we were doing a piece about Chicago politics.
just saying.
I'm not even just saying, she said it.
Hi. I worked for NPR like starting 20 years ago, which was like a very different era. And I'm very interested now in...
Were you like 4 years old?
I know, I was going to say. No, actually, how did you... How is that possible? How is that even...
Okay. I'm at the Times now, which is like a very different... And I'm saying this sort of the whatever resume thing, because what I find really interesting, both now where I am and also observing NPR after being in public radio for a long time, is the sense that like reporter as character is a different approach. It's suddenly there's a sort of a freeing up in a way that like has, I mean, it's not sudden, it's like the 10-year overnight mm-hmm. freeing up, but I'm interested in you know, Kelly, your thoughts, I mean actually all of you, mm-hmm. and also
what do you mean by reporter's character?
Well,
you mean like we personality talk, just have
kind of yeah, yeah, like yesterday we talked a lot about you know, the sense if you're a host of a podcast that you are yourself and you're writing a character mm-hmm. sometimes that is you, but not really you. And this is actually a big tradition, I think, in public radio storytelling generally. But now, you know, Kelly, you have an opportunity as you are a host, but you're also, you know, you have this podcast where you are also a character, but you are very, very much a journalist. And Hanna, you, I've just joined this, but you know, you're also kind of filling this role in a new way. And I would actually be interested in what all of you have to say about this moment as reporter, as character, is maybe more accepted or not. Anyway, mm-hmm. long question.
You, no, because oh. you, I feel like you've moved through the organization doing both. So yeah. It'd be interesting. Do you experience it as a transition?
Even on the news show, we're doing it so much more, obviously on the news shows, right? We're being people and for better or for worse, right? Like there's not, it's totally not perfect when we are like more ourselves, I think, on those news shows. I think there's times when it's like, ay, 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 be quiet, stop talking about yourself. Like, you know what I mean? Like, this is the news. You know, I do it to myself. I cry all the time, like all the time. And so like, it's just like, stop. So I mean, I think in general, I think there's this sense that we're not Walter Cronkite anymore. Like we're not the omniscient, all-seeing, all-knowing anchor. You know, I'm like a flawed, messy person. And the more I can just be that person, the more likely people are going to sort of latch on. I think there's like, and we all know there's kind of this hunger for authenticity, right? Like, it used to be that, you know, Scott Simon was who he was on the radio, and then there was this whole other life of his that you could maybe only glean from, like, his books, and, you know, if you were lucky enough to go to, like, one of these, like, appearances where he would, like, talk about himself or whatever. And I feel like, I mean, now he's got, like, a million followers on Twitter or whatever. Like, he's now, like, a person, and it's not, like, behind the scenes. It's all, like, in front of the scenes, and, so, I mean, I think generally there's just a trend toward that on the radio. In podcasts, obviously, it's like a whole nother step, you know, like you're saying all kinds of stuff about yourself. And that's, I mean, I remember when I first got to NPR 5 years ago, there was this rule that, like, we were never supposed to even be on tape, like as correspondents, right? Hosts is kind of a different thing. But like as a correspondent, as a foreign correspondent, I was supposed to say, told a reporter, you know, which you guys have to do in the newspaper. Still, he told a reporter, I was like, I will never say those words on the radio, ever. Like, I just kept putting myself on tape because I just can't not. And, like, just saying the word I and me and whatever until they, like, realized they weren't going to fire me. So that was just like, I mean, that was the cardinal rule, like, 5 years ago for correspondents. And some correspondents still do it. So I think there's like a breaking through in that. In podcasts, it's really, you know, interesting. I think there's a lot of people in the newsroom who are super queasy about it. I think there's people who don't like it at all. You know, just like, why are you making my old editor? Just like, I made a first person documentary that was an hour long. And he's still, every time I see him, is just like, I don't know. That was kind of too much for me. You know, I mean, he's like old school, but like, it was still just like, too many feelings. I mean, I'm the kind of person who thinks that we should be ourselves, because I think if we can be ourselves and just be completely transparent and honest about who we are, we're not perfect. We're super messed up. Just like, come along with me on this super messed up journey. I don't know what's gonna happen, but like, you know, if you want to come, you know, you'll probably cry.
Maria, do you feel like when you started your thing, did you set out explicit rules that were different than the rules that you had lived by for
years? Oh, you mean when we started Futuro?
Yeah. Like, were you like, we're not going to, was it explicit or were you, did you not?
No. The only explicit, one, we try to create a very diverse and open newsroom. Explicitly, there are two words that we don't use, minority or illegal, to describe a human being. So those are like the explicit things. Mm-hmm. And the thing about what we've done with Latino USA is that we did, over the last 6 years since Futuro Media was created and took over the production, we have brought in the voices of our producers. Mm-hmm. But I think the real key here is to know when to do it and when not to do it. You know, like, again, on the podcast In the Thick, which is a politics podcast that we launched, and we're trying to have a much more conversational tone, but it's a politics podcast, so I'm never, I don't say what I feel, but I'm more, it's a different character. On Latino USA, I have a different personality in different moments. I think it's about knowing when to pull back, you know, when it's too much, and I think you know it. It's like, you can be just like, okay, nah, like you said, it's like, and also, like, there are also places where I don't want to know what you're thinking or feeling necessarily as an anchor giving me the evening news.
Right.
Like, I just don't, actually. Right. I really just want you at the BBC over there in London to just tell me what's going on.
Francesca, I'd love to hear what you think about this.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, like, right from the beginning, we were totally embracing character and our, the kind of characters of our reporters within the piece. I set up a podcast called Islamophonic, I think, in 2007 with a very young female Islamic reporter, and it was all about her. Like, she was a really big character, and she totally threw herself into it. And it was a really fun podcast, but very much from her perspective of being a kind of British Muslim woman. And that was absolutely what we were looking for. I think you're right that it can be forced. You've got to get the right people. You can't just say, like, be a personality now. Come on, perform.
Go, emote.
Because that's, like, horrible. But, yeah, finding the right people and the right level and when it's appropriate for the program, I think, I mean, one of the nice things about podcasting is you can experiment. Like, you can experiment in You know, it's a kind of, it's a space for R&D, isn't it? So we can be, you know, playing around and seeing what does work without the restrictions of broadcasting slots.
Right. I think we're going to have to wrap it up there. I'm sorry to say that, but thank you to Hanna Rosin, Francesca Panetta, Maria Hinojosa. Thanks, you guys.